compassion and all that he has been. praise the Lord, O my soul, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, O my soul, praise the Lord.
Sometimes we think that praising the Lord is loud, but sometimes praising the Lord is quiet, just like this. Hear the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. You are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him. This is a privilege, isn't it? Privilege. So we are to declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into the wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy.
Thank you,
God.
I was a wretch. I remember who I was. I was lost, I was blind, I was running out of time. Sin separated, the breach was far too wide. The far side of the chasm, you held me in your side. So you made a way across the great divide. Behind heaven's throne, to build it here inside. There at the cross, you paid the debt I owe.
Thank him for it.
Thank you. blood apply. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name.
This morning, Lord, we do declare glory to your name. Not to us, but to your name be the glory. For who you are, for what you have done, may your name be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. At this time, we're going to go to the Lord in prayer, and as we do, we'll ask you to stand if there's a request that is on your heart, or if you'd like to intercede on behalf of someone else. But I ask you to especially be in prayer for Hanfield families. There's been a lot of loss of loved ones just in this past week with a number of families that we'll pray for, but I would ask you to continue to keep them in your prayers as well. So as we go to the Lord this morning, if you would like to stand with requests of your own or intercede on behalf of someone else, would you stand at this time? Heavenly Father, we do come here this morning to give glory to your name. The glory is yours, and Lord, may we reflect your glory to the world. But may we not take that glory for ourselves, but may we reflect it back to you. So may we show your glory as we also glorify you. Lord, may we be your shining light. We prayed for a true revival. We sung about that this morning, Lord, and may that happen. May there be a revival. Hearts turning to you, to your ways. Lord, we pray for relationships to be in a right place with you. As you can come and forgive sin, as we've sung about this morning too, Lord, how we can be forgiven, how we are, how our sin is as far as the east is from the west. You have taken and separated our sin from us, and we are thankful for that this morning. Lord, we pray right now for anyone that is in here or anyone that may be watching online, that if they find themselves tangled in sin, if they're trapped or in that web of sin or that cycle of sin, Lord, that you would set them free.
That's right, yes.
Lord, we pray for freedom.
Yes.
That you would come and that you would break those chains, that you would set those free from bondage, that they could be in right relationship with you and love others completely. Lord, we pray in the name of Jesus, that the sin, that those cycles would be broken, and that we could come to you. Lord, may it start here, may it start with me, may it start with us. And we know and believe that you have the power to do that, and we give you thanks and praise, for you are a powerful and mighty God. And you love us completely, and we are so thankful for that this morning. Lord, we also come before you with requests today. We pray that you could be with those that are sick or ill. Lord, we pray for healing for people. As many people have COVID still and are dealing with other sicknesses or illnesses or in the hospital, Lord, we pray that you would be with them, that you would touch their bodies and bring about a physical restoration. We pray that you would be with them in a special way. Lord, we also pray for many families here in Hanfield who are experiencing loss over this past week. We pray that you could be with the Howards, the Pendletons, the Schiltzes, and the Boatwrights, or any others I may be forgetting, Lord, but all these families have experienced loss just of loved ones in just this past week. We pray that you would be with them in a special way, that you would come close to those who have a broken heart,
yes,
that you would mourn with those who mourn and give them your comfort and your peace that surpasses all understanding. And Lord, most of all, may we be hopeful in those who know you, that death is not the end, that they can share in your victory. So, Lord, we give you thanks for that hope. And, Lord, we pray that you could be with these families, that you would surround them and comfort them in a special way. Again, God, we give you thanks for for who you are and for being here with you this morning, for being gathered with your people. It is a good thing, and we are thankful for this place and for these people this morning.
Yes.
Lord, we pray that today you would open our eyes that we may see you, that you may open our ears that we may hear from you, that you would open our hearts and minds so that we could understand. May we turn to you and be healed. We pray all this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray.
Our
Father,
Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, we're going to dismiss our children to the second half ministry. Miss Shirley's in the back there. So we will say a prayer for our children as they head on their way, and also a prayer for the tithes and offerings that have been or will be collected. So let us pray. God, we give you thanks for these children and their families. And Lord, we also pray that their hearts and minds would be open to hear from you and to understand and grow in relationship and knowledge of who you are as their Savior. Lord, we also pray that you could be with the tithes and offerings that have been or will be collected. We give you thanks for both the gift and the giver. May we be good stewards with what we receive. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you for saving me. What can I say? You are my everything.
tell it right now how great he is. Great are you, Lord.
It is good to be with you. Amen. That's better. So I just want you to know my sermon will probably be like 25% longer and not as good because I can't use my hands. So just that's how that works. It's really unfortunate. This week we are concluding our sermon series on the tiny book of Jude. And the book of Jude is an interesting a little book. We spent 5 weeks on it now. It was originally going to be a 3-week sermon series, but this will be week number 5. That's kind of how that happened. I saw a meme the other day that was something about, if the pastor sees a shadow, the sermon series will be 6 more weeks or something. And I was like, ouch. But actually, we had to be done this week because next week we're having a guest preacher. So we had a firm cutoff. I'm actually really excited. Next week we are having a guest preacher that I've been looking forward to for a long time, and his name is Greg Hyatt. And he was my childhood pastor. So from the time I was about 3 years old until the time I was 18 and went off to college, he was my pastor. Just kind of for a point of reference for you all, he and Pastor Tim, who's here today, thank you, good to see Pastor Tim. Pastor Tim went to seminary together and attended seminary together, and were ordained the same year. And I believe you were the last two serving. Is that correct? The last two people from their ordination class serving and pastoring. So he just retired maybe a little over a year ago now, and I've been looking forward to having him come and to share with us. And actually, kind of also exciting for me next week, I thought while he was here, I would have him actually baptize our daughter, Abigail, because I thought that'd be kind of cool. But partly because, not that it matters who does it, really, but I just thought, I don't want to do it. Somebody told me a long time ago, this has nothing to do with what we're talking about today, this is for free. Somebody told me a long time ago that there's something about, like, I could baptize her myself, but I just want to be dad, you know? Because somebody needs to ask me those questions that we ask parents at baptisms. Will you do all in your power to to raise this child in the way. Somebody needs to ask me that. Okay. So anyway, next week. So all that to say, we had to be done this week, right? So hard deadline. Got to finish up on Jude this week. Our passage this morning is one of the loftiest and grandest doxologies in the Bible. You've often heard it maybe somewhere. A lot of times it's used at funerals. I used it at a funeral on Friday. I mean, that's where we hear this one a lot. But we never really hear it in context. We don't know where it has come from. And it's fantastic when you hear it out of context, but when you hear it in the context of what Jude has been talking about and describing, it becomes even better. So sometimes people refer to this these last couple of verses as a benediction, right? I've maybe done that myself, but it's not a benediction, it's a doxology. So the word benediction means, it comes from bene, meaning good, diction, meaning, you know, dictum, meaning word, so it's good words. When I pronounce the benediction, we're speaking good words. It's a blessing over the people. But a doxology is actually the opposite. It's not good words spoken over the people. It is proclaiming praise to God. So that's what this is. And a lot of times we come to the end of these letters, and we kind of, like we talked about at the beginning, we skip over the beginning of letters in the New Testament, right? Because we think, okay, written to so-and-so, all right, let's get to the point. And when we come to the end, we say, okay, praise be to God and thanks and all that stuff, and like, all right, let's get to the end. You know, isn't that what we do, right? But I would encourage us not to do that. And in fact, today we'll see that is a bit of a serious mistake, especially when it comes to Jude. So Jude writes here, the final verses of his letter. He says in verse 24, "Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to make you stand in the presence of his glory blameless with great joy, to the only God our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, and now and forever. Amen." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I have a temptation after a passage like that to say, go in peace, to love and serve the Lord. I mean, this is really, really good stuff. So Jude, what he does here in this last couple of verses, he packs a lot of stuff into these verses. And here in this passage, he has some important things to say. He packs a lot into each sentence. I described someone this week, I think I got a few weird looks, that Jude, when he writes, it's like, has anyone ever seen the show Gilmore Girls? Okay, Jude writes like the Gilmore Girls speak, okay? If you haven't seen it, it doesn't mean anything to you. Where it's just like, I mean, and there's like, you know, about three different illustrations packed into every sentence, and they just, you know, it's like totally unrealistic dialogue. If you've ever seen that show, not an endorsement. Please don't watch it. Okay, just trust me. All right, but that's kind of what Jude packs a lot into every single sentence, and that's no less true here. Once again, we see several layers to the things he's saying. We see, kind of on the first layer here, we see this wonderful description of what God can do for us. He shows us, it's a wonderful description of what God can do. As we see here in this benediction, he mentions several things that God can do for us. And the first, we see that he says, "Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling." He says that God can keep us from stumbling. He says, remember, he says this idea that God can keep us. If you notice, that's kind of been the theme of the song we've sung, we've closed every service with for the last several weeks in Jude. That's the theme of it, is that God can keep us. Right, it's based on this benediction. In verse 1, he says, and remember in verse 1, this has been a theme throughout the verse, because in verse 1, he said that we were kept for Jesus Christ. And we talked about the time that being kept, meaning, in this context, means steadfast care and nurturing of something in someone's steadfast care and nurturing of something in someone's possession. In other words, he tells Jude that he will safeguard, that God will safeguard them. God guards them from falling away. They're given strength to endure in the face of temptation and have power, he says, to remain faithful to Christ. He said that in the first verse, and now he's returned to it in the last verse, which is important because if you remember all of the stuff that he has said in between, right? This idea of being kept becomes a lot more important. You remember, he said all these harsh things, stuff that Judas told people, both the what not to do, you know, demonstrated by the false teachers, and the what to do that we talked about last week. And after all of that, they need to be reminded that God can empower them to do all the things that Jude has been asking them to do. And so that's what he says here. That's why he says that in the benediction. He can help them endure until the day of Christ Jesus. You know, 1 Corinthians 1:8 says it this way. It says, he will also keep you firm to the end so that you'll be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, who has called you into fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. God is ultimately the one who can keep them from coming under the deception of these false teachers he's been talking about, and who can keep them in every other way also until that day of Christ Jesus. Until the day of Christ Jesus. Next, Jude tells them that God can make them stand in the presence of his glory blameless with great joy. He can make them stand in his presence of his glory blameless with great joy. See, this is important. After all of the junk that Jude has talked about in the last few paragraphs earlier, and all the ways they can go astray, he tells them that God can make them blameless before the Lord. God can make them blameless before the Lord. You know, it's interesting as you read through the Old Testament. I know some of you are participating in Brad's reading through the Bible in a year thing, and if you're not, it's not too late, right, Brad? Can we get? Okay, but if you're reading through the Old Testament, you see all of the procedures and all of the rituals and all of the things that it takes so that one person once a year can go in and be in the presence of God. And so you get this idea that all of the structure that it takes in order for one person one time a year to go and stand before the Ark of the Covenant and be somewhat in the presence of God. All of that. And so we get this idea, you get a sense then of the holiness of God. And just one, so one does not simply walk into the presence of God, right? That's what that means. I think often of the portrayal of this that you get from Indiana Jones, amen. You know, Indiana Jones, the scene. You know, this is not the kind of clip you can show in church, okay? You know the scene in the Ark where they uncover the Ark of the Covenant, you know, and then they're all kind of like just melted by kind of this theatrical portrayal of the presence of God, right? The ark, right? See, that's, you know, sometimes I think, well, that's not, you know, I mean, we come into the presence of God when we're in sin, and you know, we just, that's maybe kind of how it would work. I don't know. Yeah, I mean, you get this impression, like, that's not totally inaccurate, right? But now Jude says that because of Christ, we can not only walk into the presence of God, but we can walk in how? With joy. We can walk in with joy. The work of Christ, the work that Christ does to make us blameless, we could walk in with joy because of it. And just even as Derek was praying about the freedom from the guilt of sin and freedom from the practice of sin that we can experience, that's what it means to be blameless. And he says, because we can be made blameless, we can walk in with joy. You see, and I like that because, you know, some of you think, well, I'm going to walk in, and I'm going to be a little bit nervous, you know what I mean? Like, we can walk in like, look out, here it comes. You know, like, you do kind of with that in the back of our mind, you know, like, here, the Lord's going to smite me. Knew I should have confessed that. You know, I mean, no, he says, no, like, not even like with a little bit with one eye closed. We can walk in with joy because we can be made that blameless because of the work of Christ. Wow, that's awesome. That's awesome. That's the level of confidence we can have that God is able to keep us and make us blameless, Jude tells us. I like the way that Paul describes this in Ephesians 5. In Ephesians 5:25, he's telling husbands how husbands ought to love their wives, and he's making a comparison between that and how Christ loves the church. He's saying, you know, Christ should love, or the husbands should love their wives as Christ loved the church. And he says this, husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself up for her. And here he tells us how Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her so that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of the water with the word, and that he might present to himself the church in all her glory, having no spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she would be holy and blameless. That's that same image of describing how the Lord can make the church that is his bride holy and blameless. That's what he says. Isn't that awesome? Without spot or wrinkle. And some of us, again, we look in the spiritual mirror, and we're kind of like, ooh, got some spots there. You know what I'm saying? But he can make us holy and blameless. That's what he tells us. That's awesome. That's the awesome power of God. And partly that's true because of the next thing that he kind of alludes to here. is that he tells us that God can do for us is to save us. He can save us. In verse 25, he says, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ. He refers to God as Savior. Now, that might not strike you as a little bit strange, but it's a pretty unusual thing, actually. We talk about, the Bible talks often about Jesus as a Savior, right? But do we talk about God as a Savior? Not usually. Not usually. But Jude, that's what he does here. And what he does is he's making a point. He's making a point of how deep this goes, that God's desire is to be a Savior. It's deep in his nature to want to save that which he's created and that which he loves. And so through Jesus Christ, the work on his cross, he's willing to save us from sin and death. Like we said a few moments ago, separate us from our, as far as the east is from the west. And you know, thanking God for saving us. All the stuff we just sang about. That's what he says here. That God himself is our Savior because of what he has done for us. So this is what he describes. This is the picture that we get here. Is that he this is what God does for us. This is kind of the first layer, if you will, of what's going on in Jude. He keeps us. He makes us blameless. He saves us. So this doxology points to all of those amazing things that God can do for us. But that's not what Jude's real intention is here, actually, in this passage. Jude is actually introducing him. He's just introducing God. He's saying who God is, not necessarily trying to tell us what God can do. So if we emphasize the fact that that it's described here about what God can do for us, then we're actually missing the point of these couple verses. Because if you notice, Jude doesn't actually get to the verb in the sentence. It's a really weird sentence. This is bad English. You know, if you get to the main verb of the sentence until verse 25, it's actually a weird sentence. So he says the main action of the sentence is to ascribe glory to God. And the purpose of this description is a description of the one to whom we're ascribing glory, right? So if he had wanted to, Jude could have just said, been very to the point and said, now to God be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, now and forever, amen. Right? That's not what he did. He could have just said, now to God. And that would have been much more direct and much more succinct and, you know, would have been a lot, that would have made a lot more kind of sense, you know. But instead, he doesn't just say God. He tells you who God is by describing what he does. It's this lengthy description that could be summed up. He says, now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to make you blameless and so on, like he says all of that rather than just saying, now to God. What it reminds me of is kind of, if you ever, like a boxing announcer, you know, and in this corner, you know, and they never just say the person's name, and in this corner we have Curtis. You know what I mean? No, it's always like, and in this corner we, you know, such and so wing. This is a game I play with Elizabeth. She's got like a, because maybe I'm like a little kid, Jen, she has one of those Echo microphones. And so I do this all the time with her, and she loves it. She'd like to start jumping up and down, because I'll say, and in this corner, standing at 3.5 feet tall, weighing in at 34 pounds, you know. And I make up all kinds of names, the cute cuddler, the tiny terror, you know. And just go, like, start, like, and the Elizabeth Banker. And she loves it. She's like jumping up and down. She's like, that's me, you know. Anyway. So now we added in her sister, weighing in at 16 pounds, you know. But that's almost what Jude is doing. He could have just said, now here's God. But he says, now to him who is able to keep us from stumbling. And he adds in all of these things describing who the person is without actually saying it until he gets to the point. Do you see what I mean? So that's what Jude is doing. And so you don't actually get to the verb in the sentence until verse 25. Which is interesting. If you're trying to read this passage and you don't understand that, then we're missing something. So I remember I was actually this week I was watching a popular teacher, had a video series about this thing, and I was watching her kind of describe this, a video of her describing this verse, and she was talking about how this Jude verse 24 is one of her favorite verses in the Bible, and I was like, that didn't make any sense, and it was obvious to me at that point. I was like, this person has not taken Derek's How to Study the Bible class. Skip that one, you know? Because verse 24 can't be your favorite verse. It's half a sentence, you know? It's like, it would be like if you were to say to me, you know, hey, what do you have any advice for me? And I would say, yes. You know, in that situation, if I were you, I would. And you were to be like, That advice was so helpful. Thank you. I mean, that, so it's only half a sentence, right? So all of that stuff, all of the stuff that Judah's saying in verse 24 is a description of the person about whom he's talking. So all of these things that God can do are actually a description of who God is, not simply what he can do. So he keeps us from stumbling. Why? Because he's all powerful. He's all powerful, yet loving towards those whom he's created. He makes us holy and blameless because he is holy. And because of Christ's work as our Savior, he saves us from our guilt and sin and frees us from the stain of it. And it is because of his love that he's inclined to do so. He's telling us who God is. He's introducing God. And then in verse 25, he goes on to tell us more about God. We get a picture of a God who is eternal before all things and is now in all things and is all powerful. So he could have just said God. But why does Jude, think about this with me, why does Jude, the guy who has no time for fluffy stuff, right, has more theology and more stuff densely packed into one little book, why does he go on? You know, this is a guy, remember in verse 1, in the beginning, he doesn't go through the normal introduction process when he's like, now I thank God every time. I mean, he doesn't do any of that. He gets right to the point, right? This is a guy, like, if you remember, we said at the end, they usually come to the end of the book, and it's like, now greet so-and-so, and he didn't have any time for that. So why does he do that? Why does he spend all that time when one word would have solved it? I think it's this. The purpose of this first part of the passage, and it's not simply to tell us what God can do for us, but to describe who he is so that he is revealed as a God worthy of our worship. So that he's revealed as a God who's worthy of our worship. Remember, that's what a doxology does. So we see here a description of what God can do, but deeper than that is a description of who he is, and that points us to worship. So we see here not only what God can do for us, who he is, but we also see what our response should be to him. It all hinges on that primary, what is kind of the primary verb in this whole sentence is translated to be glory. Right? Glory. He says, to him who, then insert all of this description of God, be glory, to him be glory, majesty, dominion, authority, before all time, now, and forever. Amen. Glory in this context, it means dignity, honor, praise, worship. Jude is saying, may God be given honor and praise and worship that is rightly due him because of who he is. And so that's the thing. Even if he had never done anything for us, he would still be worthy of our praise because of who he is. He's worthy of our praise. He goes on to describe not just the glory, but he says majesty, which is greatness or magnificence. He says, and dominion and power. The word dominion here refers to the fact that God is sovereign over everything. He is sovereign over all things, ruling over me and over everything else. Power refers to the authority possessed by God, and all of that, he says, should be given to the Lord before all time, now and forevermore. In other words, he's talking about should be given to the Lord in the past, in the present, right now, and in the future, all of that. Verse 25 ends with this word of praise. Because of who God is, he's worthy of being worshipped. All of what Jude says in verse 24 and 25 is simply a description of a God who is worthy of our praise. He's worthy of all the glory that we can possibly bring him. So right here at the end of the letter, I think Jude clues us into something that is critical. And that is, it's almost the answer to the unasked question of what is the point of all of this? All of the stuff that Jude has been saying, what is the point of everything he's written in the letter up to this point? The purpose of it all is that it should bring a glory to God. That's the purpose of a life well lived in the way that Jude is describing, is to bring glory to God. I think that's the purpose of all of the stuff in the book, all of the handing down the faith, all of the defending the faith, the living righteously, the avoiding evil, the doing that which is good, the remaining in the faith, the rescuing others. The purpose of all of that stuff that he's talked about is to bring glory to God, to bring glory to God. That's the purpose of a Christian life. It's never to bring glory to ourselves. That's a trap we can fall into. It's never to bring glory to ourselves. The purpose of what we should do is never to bring glory to ourselves, but glory to God. Incidentally, I think that's the trap that the people in the false teachers have fallen into, is they thought it was about bringing glory to themselves. Right? Derek has a shirt a sweat, I think it's a sweatshirt or something I've seen you wear that says famous enough, right? Famous enough. I like that because, and the whole idea being that our objective in life should not be to make ourselves famous, but to make Him famous. That's the objective of our life, is not make ourselves famous, not bring honor and glory to ourselves, but to make Him famous. To make Him famous. And so that's the trap that these false teachers, part of what they'd fallen into is, and this is a trap that people, particularly in ministry, frankly, they fall into is bringing glory to themselves, right? And so every time we see that, we should kind of hold that with suspicion. Oh, that's kind of a red flag right there. If somebody's about themselves and making themselves famous and bringing glory to themselves, that we should kind of have a question mark on that, right? Because I think of the opposite of that is like one of my favorite prayers. We've talked about this prayer before. Is John Wesley's covenant prayer, his watch night prayer. He says, "I am no longer my own, but thine. Put me to what thou wilt. Rank me with whom thou wilt. Put me to doing for thee, or suffering. Put me to doing, or put me to suffering. Put me to be exalted for thee, or brought low for thee. I freely and heartily yield all things to thy glory and disposal." That's the idea, right? That's what Wesley said. That's the image of a life that's lived bringing glory to God, not to ourselves. So the question we have to ask ourselves is, does the way that I'm living, including all of those things, all of the stuff that Jude has been talking about, defending the faith, handing down, rescuing others, I mean, all of the stuff that we've been talking about, am I including all of those things, does the way that I'm doing that bring glory to God? Does the way I'm running my business, going about my affairs, going to school, whatever it is, does the way I'm studying, does the way I'm doing all of that bring glory to God? Because if it does, then I think we have an opportunity to be a powerful witness to the rest of the world. Just a powerful witness. The rest of kind of our society, we've talked about before how we're moving in what is called a post-Christendom era, right? That we are losing the Christianity's influence at the center of society and as defining what is moral and immoral in society, right? We've talked about this before. And as that happens, things will necessarily become more chaotic, right? Because when you don't live in the way that God has prescribed, remember the theological term we talked about a few weeks ago, you get messed up. Right? You get messed up. And so inherently, when we don't live in the way that God has prescribed, it leads towards chaos. Those of you who are in ABFs that are studying the for the body thing, you're going through that. I mean, that is basically it's putting forth a positive vision of Christianity and our theology of the body and stuff like that. But conversely, it talks about the project that is in our society of redefining sex and marriage and gender and every other thing, right? And inherently, those things, it leads to chaos. And so the whole idea is like when that project fails, and it will, when that happens, I want people who are going to be looking for something, right? And I want them to be, you know, as their lives fall apart or as, you know, society falls apart or whatever, like, people are going to be looking for something. And I want them to be able to have something to grab a hold of, to look at us as Christians and to say, you know what, to see us as Christians and see us in us something that they want. Say, hey, you know what, those Christians, they seem to have it together a little bit, right? I mean, their marriages are, they look at their marriages, look at their lives. They seem to be pretty loving. They seem to be, you know, helping other people. They're humble. They've got something that I need. I need to go find out what that is. I need to go find out what it is. And when that happens, ultimately people will be not drawn to us, but ultimately to the God that we serve. What is that? But it's bringing glory to God. That's what it means to live a life that brings glory to God in all the ways that Jude has been describing. That's what we do. We seek to glorify God with our lives. And invite the worship team to come back up and then lead us in the closing song that they have been these last several weeks. But the question this doxology calls us to ask ourselves is this: because I recognize who He is and what He has done for me, am I willing to do all in my power to live in a way that brings glory to God? Am I willing to do all in my power to do all that I can to bring glory to God? Because if we will, then we can live in a way that brings glory to God. We can experience all that God has for us and not only defend the faith and hand it down to the next generation, as Jude's been describing, but I think we can thrive in doing so. Thanks be to God.
Pastor Tim's here. He taught me to be all about seeking the lost, but making disciples. He doesn't know it, but he did one day when I went into his office because I was despairing against the world. He brought me back around. Thank you. All of our pastors, for our children, want the light. We didn't raise our kids so Satan could have them. Does he have power to hold our children? Absolutely. Pastor Brad will tell you that. All of our pastors, Derek, Shirley. Sorry. Go on. When dangers. I'm going to start that over. When dangers creep up beneath you, like hidden reefs below, when wandering stars above don't lead you home, when people promise blessing like clouds that promise rain, these pretty lying mist they whisper vain, when wild waves surround you
simply means, so be it. May it be so. And that is my prayer this morning as we've studied this doxology, that we've learned that the Lord is able to keep us from stumbling in a minute and present us to himself, and that he would be glorified. So to that we can simply say, amen. Amen. May it be so. As we depart this worship service, I leave you with these words. Now may the love of the Father, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship and sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest and abide on each and every one of you. Until Jesus comes or calls. Amen.